President, Professor Shuniti Kumar Pathak. The minister has left, so I'll move on to Venerable Pomnoon Sunim, Venerable Laba Zomdang, His Holiness Sangharaja Dharmasena Mahasthavir, His Holiness Sanghanayaka Sudhananda Mahathera, Reverend Abbess Yuan Ming. I'm just back from your country. Then Arundhati Ghosh, Chief Master, Postmaster General, Sri R.K. Krimbe, former Minister, Mr. Hemendra Vikas Chaudhuri, General Secretary of the Bodh Gaya Dharmankur Sabha, and Venerable Bhikshu Bodhipala. He is a live wire of energy. But if you have noticed before I start, that he always has a gamcha, and there's no amount of heat that can deter him because every 5 minutes he mops his head. Ami Bangla bolte khub pochondo kortam, kintu ajke upay nei, eto bidesh theke eto gonnomanno lok eschen. পরবর্তীকালে এই লেখাটিকে আমি বলে দেবো, ওরা জগৎজ্যোতিতে অন্য জায়গায় বাংলায় করে নেবে, খুব একটা সাংঘাতিক ব্যাপার নয়। করে দিয়েছেন? আচ্ছা, ছাপিয়ে দেবো পরে। সো আই টেক ইউর লিবার্টি টু স্টার্ট উইথ, ইটস এ গ্রেট অনার টু মি টু বি ডেলিভারিং দ্য সিক্স কৃপাসরণ মেমোরিয়াল লেকচার, বাট বিফোর আই গেট ইন টু আ হোল ফরেস্ট অফ ওয়ার্ডস অ্যান্ড এক্সপ্রেশনস, I'd like to be very clear on what is the objective that I seek to place before you. The first is, hey, bhai, tumi pore distribute karo. Pore distribute karo. Tal kete jabe. The first is that Buddhism had to be rediscovered. I've used a very small, innocent term, but it's loaded with historical context. In other words, for a long time, or well over 1,000 years, India had almost forgotten Buddhism. That's the first fact that you need to get in, because most people tend to think that this is a continuum in terms of the textbooks that we have read. We had the Mohenjo-daro Harappan period, we had the Vedic civilization, we had the Buddhist and Mauryan period, we had the Guptas, and Buddhism continued, and then came Islamic rule. Friends, it's not actually so. Our memory went through certain fault systems. I call it historical amnesia. And I'll explain what I mean by filling in the gap retrospectively. That's the first thing that I would like to present. The second is, why is it that this loss of memory took place? And why is it that it had to be discovered first by the British? In other words, I pose a question: if the British archaeologists had not found out the glory of Buddhism, would we remember the contribution of the greatest religion of India in the same light? We assume that we are all today very, very respectful towards this religion. But the small point is, why did we need to forget, and why did we need to re-remember, rediscover? The third issue is analogous to that, and I'll move on. It is also my personal way of paying tribute to Kripasaran Mahasthavir. One of the reasons is that I feel that Venerable Kripasaran needs to be re-evaluated. In the rediscovery of Buddhism, in the laying of the claim of Buddhism to the soul of India, to the heritage of India, we have several persons who have been held, and rightly so. Without Nagarika Dharmapala, there would be no revival in the sense in which we see Buddhism today. But at the same time, the role played by Kripasaranji has also to be re-evaluated. His problem was that, or his asset was that he communicated in the vernacular, in the people's language. And therefore we have not so many records in a communicative language of English, the international language of English. উনি বাংলায় বলতেন বলে আর বাংলায় আমার জেলা চট্টগ্রামের বাংলাটা একটু আলাদা, হ্যাঁ সেখানে ভাষায় বলতেন বলে বোধ হয় সেভাবে মূল্যায়ন করা হয়নি। দিজ আর মোর লেস থ্রি থিংস দ্যাট আই উইল বি সেইং অ্যান্ড ইটস এ গ্রেট অনার ফর মি টু বি ডেলিভারিং দ্য সিক্স কৃপাসরণ মেমোরিয়াল লেকচার উইচ হ্যাজ বিন হিদার টু ডেলিভার্ড বাই গ্রেট স্কলার্স অফ রেপিউট এক্সেপ্ট দ্য এফেকশন অ্যান্ড ইন্ডালজেন্স অফ মাই ওয়েল উইশেস and a deep abiding tenacity to carry on with some research in spite of my backbreaking work, I have really nothing to commend for such an honor. I am being sincere. The man who would have loved to see me here today is no more. I refer to my respected father, who instilled in us not only a spirit of open inquiry, but a great regard for the district he hailed from, the bastion of Buddhism in Bengal, Chittagong. This is a small tribute to my father as well. Now let me begin. A few days ago, the Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh did a Bhumi Puja at a site in Guntur district that he called the new city of Amravati, the new capital of Andhra. This is very interesting because it was near to this area that in 1798, Colonel Colin Mackenzie had stumbled upon some puzzling ruins while he was traversing the Guntur-Nellore region as part of the British campaign against Tipu Sultan. If you recall, the British had put all their energies in crushing Tipu Sultan, and in 1799, Colonel Mackenzie was part of the victorious campaign. But what is more interesting to us is that Colonel Mackenzie stumbled across, though he had heard of some strange carved rocks from local villagers, he could hardly understand the significance because he had to move on with his troops for the final assault upon Tipu Sultan. We may recall that it was the very next year that the British secured their final victory against Tipu at Srirangapatnam. But something ringed in Mackenzie's mind, thank God, because he revisited that area several years later in 1816. In his new capacity as the Surveyor General of India. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like you to remember the year 1816. We are now in 2015, exactly 199 years ago. 199 years ago, we had no idea what was Buddhism. This is the point. Now, he came back. For the next 4 years, Mackenzie made several illustrations of what he thought were old ruins of Deccan Buddhist Jainism. Now problem is, the Deccan had both Buddhism and Jainism, but Jainism was more prevalent, at least in Tamil country, Karnataka, whereas Buddhism was more prevalent in Kerala. But these are all historical issues. He thought that they were Deccan Jainism. And he made a presentation in Park Street before the Asiatic Society, which said that this is the ruins of Jainism. Now, Jainism had never been wiped off our memory. What had happened was with Buddhism. He presented documents and 85 sketches of Amravati before the Asiatic Society in Calcutta. No one understood then that these findings actually related to another religion that India had almost forgotten, Buddhism. It was soon to come back silently to haunt India's historical landscape, from which it had disappeared 1,000 years ago, equally silently. So effectively had Buddhism been forgotten that very few people even had the slightest idea of what were its phenomenal contribution to Indian and world civilization. Almost all the grandeur of pre-Islamic India, like the mighty stupas of Sarnath and Sanchi, or the universities of Taxila and Nalanda that we take to be a part of our proud heritage, had all been lying covered under centuries of neglect or destruction or both. The mighty stupas of yore had become ghostly ruins from which people would steal bricks. They were reduced to just names names of places like Dhamek Stupa, which is incidentally a very interesting word. Dhamek Stupa can mean both the destroyed stupa, the stupa that was destroyed, or the ruins of a stupa. It can mean either or. Very interesting. Even place names like Panchstupi. Panchstupi is in Burdwan. It refers to Pancho Stup. Panchstupi or the Bhilsa Top, which is Sarnath, meant nothing to us. And the majesty of early Indian architecture and the sculpted arts that one now observes with so much rapt attention at Ajanta or Sanchi had little relevance to Indians just 2 centuries ago. How many knew where the great temple of Bodh Gaya, the veritable Vatican of Buddhism, had disappeared? They knew it was somewhere in the Gaya region. Nobody knew where it was. Buddhism had survived and prospered outside its homeland, but in the cradle and nursery, in its existence was snuffed out, not only physically, but in terms of history, education, and popular memory. So strong was the power of forgetfulness, of amnesia, that when officers of the Madras army stumbled upon some caves in the Bombay Presidency in 1819, that's another year to remember, just about 196 years ago. It's very interesting. The Madras army, one of the sections of Madras army was chasing when went out for deer hunting. And in chasing the deer, they managed to get into through thickets and stumbled upon the valley of Ajanta. Had it not been for a deer and had it not been for an enterprising captain, all the Indian guards told him not to proceed further because this was prohibited territory. Anyway, but it's very interesting again when I look at it, that just below the hills of Ajanta, practically below, lie the splendor of Ellora. Ellora was never forgotten. Ellora was never forgotten. So it's very interesting how the pattern develops. Now, so when they stumbled upon the caves in Bombay Presidency in 1819, no one could even recall the name of these wonderful caves. So the site had to be denoted by the name of the nearest village, and the nearest village happened to be the village of Ajanta. A small village would give its name to the finest form of art. This is the kind. Even after that, it took more than 80 years for the British and Indians to understand and appreciate the real purport of what was unearthed at Ajanta. It was only after 80 years, that's close to the end of the 19th century, that we could start telling the whole world that it was this magnificent Ajanta art of India that influenced the religious art of more than one-third of the human race. From China, we have the Tunhuang caves. There are lots of styles that have taken inspiration from Ajanta, but we had ourselves blocked Ajanta from our memory. Let us quickly recapitulate some of the other major Buddhist monuments that were discovered in less than a century from Mackenzie's Amravati. The next significant discovery was of the Mankiala Stupa at Taxila by General Ventura in 1830. Taxila was the very ancient city, the capital of King Ambi, who had witnessed Alexander's sweep into India, a city that is fixated in our memory. Even Taxila, which had, I'll go on, and a city that carried valuable evidence of several periods, pre-Mauryan, Indo-Greek and Kushan, had disappeared. But how did the British find out what Indians had forgotten? That's a very interesting question. One was their boundless curiosity, and the other was their scorn for Indian concepts of purity and impurity. Indians were burdened with the concepts of this is pure, this is impure, this is allowed, this is not permitted, as well as for ghosts and evil spirits. The prohibition against getting into ruins was that it's populated by ghosts, bhutadurbe, and evil spirits that prohibited Indians from venturing into ruins. This is a very interesting aside. Bharatpur was another Buddhist site in Burdwan that was excavated when I was there. That is around 85-86. I had a bit of a challenge with the archaeologist who was there, that while formal memory forgets every archaeological site and it has to be rediscovered, people's memory do not. Let me explain. Mohenjo-daro, when it was discovered, the word Mohenjo-daro itself meant the mound of the dead. That means through succeeding generations, the folk, the local people knew that there were dead civilizations in that hill. And so it goes on. So in Bharatpur, I had an argument with the archaeologist who said, Bharatpur is Bharatpur, there is no such popular context in Bharatpur. So I said, maybe I lose, my presumptions can't be right all the time. So we went out for a cup of tea at the next tea stall at about 1 mile away from Bharatpur. And there in the tea stall, the fellow who was serving us tea asked us, "Kothay geslen?" "Bhuter danga." So in the popular memory, the word bhuter danga sticks there. So you see, there is a two layers of memory. One, what we call the structured memory of history, philosophy, state structure, and there is a popular memory. The popular memory cannot be crushed out. It can't be crushed out so easily. So besides, Indians were prohibited because of these prohibitions. Cobras did not deter them either. The fact that cobras inhabited these sites was no problem for the British. They could handle the cobras. But in all fairness, some dedicated scholars did utilize Indian and Chinese text to provide valuable clues to historic sites, which we ourselves had chosen to ignore. That's an interesting point. Cunningham, the first Director General of Archaeological Survey of India, depended a lot on the testimony of Chinese pilgrims and their travel accounts of Buddhist sacred texts, places in India. By using the bearings and distances mentioned by travelers like Fa Xian, by Yuan Zhang, Cunningham succeeded in fixing locations of many of these famous sites mentioned in the ancient texts and thus rediscovering them. He measured it in terms of li, that was their sign of the mile. And we could, so this is fascinating, that we have chosen to forget all this evidence, but Cunningham came and discovered them. These records, of course, had their own limitations, which resulted in all kinds of controversies. As, for instance, the identification of Kapilavastu. Here, the field speculation was very wide because of the bearings in the accounts of Chinese pilgrims were not consistent. So we have now certain issues, whether it's in Nepal or just outside. Anyway, Cunningham unraveled the mighty Dhamek Stupa at Sarnath. People who have seen the Dhamek Stupa, it's like a cylinder. It's a cylindrical. In 1835, which was quite unlike other hemispherical stupas, the half circle, because it was cylindrical, it marked the holy spot of the deer park at Sarnath, where Buddha gave his first sermon after attaining enlightenment. But it was James Prinsep's remarkable discovery of the Brahmi script 2 years later, 1837, that really shook our history. James Prinsep was a young coin maker, and it's called an assayer, who had learnt a lot of Western Asian scripts, which read from right to left. And while we were trying to understand the script in terms of Devanagari on left to right, he started by looking at it from right to left. And with a lot of effort, he could find out the words Ashok Devanang Priyang, which actually broke the sound barrier. But it was James Prince's remarkable discovery of the Brahmi scripts in 1837 that really shook our history. After so many years of speculation, Ashok Maurya was finally demystified and firmly established on the throne of Buddhism, on the throne of India. This helped in joining the dots of the missing grandeur of India's real heritage. for no one personifies the plural soul of India more than Ashoka. Cunningham's discovery of the Sanchi Stupa was perhaps the most educative of them all. People who visited the Sanchi Stupa would know, of all our stupa sites, and here again we find the name lost from memory. It was called Bhilsa after the Bhil Topa, Bhilsa Topa. And there's an entire book on how the Bhilsa Topa was recovered. When one glances through the pages of James Ferguson's History of India and Eastern Architecture, one would observe that even in the middle of the 19th century, this mound was in ruins. It's complete ruins. And the Toran and the Vedikas that surround the mighty stupa were covered with vegetation. ASI's restoration has done wonders, and we are now able to recognize each and every character from the Jataka tales on the Torana. That's wonderful. It was there all along. 1,000 years we chose not to look at it. Cunningham's doggedness led him to rediscover and re-excavate Bodh Gaya in 1861. Hamilton Buchanan had reported half a century before. That's around the early part of the 19th century. Hamilton Buchanan had reported this was a place covered by a thick forest. He also referred to a mutt and other installations having taken over. Buchanan had remarked with sadness that this was the soul of Buddhism, but there was no trace or respect for the faith of the Buddha at all. One may be justified in feeling that a symbol of defiance, Bodh Gaya required more than the forces of nature to be obliterated from human sight and mind. Cunningham's further discoveries in 1862-63 were also important in the treatment of historical memory loss. He identified Ramnagar as Ahichatra, Kosam as a great Kosambi, Sahet Mahet as the great historic Sravasti. These jewels from our past had all been discovered by the British, who on the basis of textual evidence and archaeology actually retrieved what India had chosen to forget. The indefatigable Cunningham then moved on to the Bharut Stupa and physically uprooted large numbers of stone carvings from this site in true imperial style and transported them to Calcutta's Indian Museum. For those of you who are interested in having a look at what was discovered in the 19th century, I would request you to go and see the first gallery of the Indian Museum on the right. He's physically uprooted and brought them to Calcutta. Very few people know that Bharut, the site has been half destroyed and it's actually in Kolkata. So all you need is to go and find out what was it. You can't bring Sanchi here, but you can bring Bharut, so you would know what I am talking about. Then what India had chosen to forget. And he uprooted large numbers of stone carvings from the site in true imperial style and transported them to Kolkata's Indian Museum. They served there as a classroom and exhibition of the excellence of craftsmanship for succeeding generations of art historians, archaeologists, museologists, connoisseurs to derive their education from these eloquent stones. Thus, within 8 decades from where we started, Buddhism that had died a natural death was suddenly brought back from the graveyard of our memory and resuscitated, restored. These structures and sculptures compensated somewhat for the apparent lack of India's tangible heritage. I'll explain this. You see, Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa were not discovered before 1922 and 1946. Mohenjo-Daro was 1922, Harappa is 1946. Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa enter our mindscape around 1850, when the first textbooks start mentioning a civilization that had been there before the Vedic period. Prior to that, till 1960s, I'm talking of 1960s, there are lots of ladies and gentlemen here who were educated at that period. There was no mention of Mohenjo-Daro and Harappa because people were trying to make out sense. So all our history began, the textbooks began by saying The history of India starts with the arrival of Aryans. Now that arrival is controversial, with the Aryans. Now Aryans are supposed to be around 1700 BC to around 600 AD. That was a non-material civilization. It's an eloquent civilization that rested on the spoken word, but was not material. They did not leave behind any structures. The first structures would start from the 6th century with the arrival of Gangetic monarchies, Rajagriha and the other monarchies, Magadha. So from the 6th century we get material culture of what we looked like, what we behaved, what were our houses, what, how did we look like. And from the 6th to the 6th century BC to around the 7th century AD, we have some amount of remains. And hop, skip and jump, go straight to the 13th century, the Islamic period. What were these blanks? These blanks were filled in by the Buddhist past that started from the 5th century BC and goes on uninterrupted till about the 13th century. So this, these structures compensated somewhat for the apparent lack of India's built heritage that stared blankly at us from the end of the Harappan period, which was incidentally discovered much later in between 1920 and 50. Thus, if the grandeur of Buddhist architecture and cave temples had not been discovered, the present country called India would have little to show by way of great grand architectural heritage for 2,500 years starting from 1500 BC. Nothing. Except a few temples at Ellora and those of the Pallavas. Some amount of temple work had been done at Ellora, at the cave temples, but not all of India. It is still open to speculation as to whether Buddhist edifices that the British archaeologists, especially the Scottish, incidentally, the Scottish had a very great role to play in this game. Cunningham was a Scot, Buchanan was a Scot. The Scots had had their own dialectical rivalries with the English, and Calcutta incidentally was a Scottish city. If you look around, you'll find Grant Street, Russell Street, these are all Scot names. So it was more Scots than England. And the archaeological survey, the geological survey's headquarters was Calcutta. Especially the Scots with a mission. They took pains to unearth that had actually crumbled into unrecognizable ruins just because patronage had shifted to a revived and recharged Brahmanism. Just because patronage moved, therefore the earlier structures collapsed. Some felt, however, that this is not the point, because many Buddhist sites, even as ruins, were better off than quite a few neglected Brahmanical spots. As a former, at least had some continuing patronage from Ceylon, Thailand and others. Now these are all debatable points. There were feeble voices that are willing to listen to the other side, that India was just not interested in rediscovering and reclaiming its past glory. We had surely exported the most significant intellectual and cultural contribution to the world, the religion of the Buddha and of universal peace. But why did we lose the material civilization? While ideationally we had exported, we were proud of it, materially in terms of heritage, why did we lose the material civilization of Buddhism almost forever until the spade of the British archaeologists hit stones under the ground? It is recalled that for nearly 1,000 years between the reign of Emperor Ashok in the 3rd century before Christ to the death of Harshavardhan 647 AD, Buddhism had ruled the minds and the polity of innumerable Indians. What happened during this dark interregnum of nearly 12 centuries between Harshavardhana and Amravati? Barashobachari ki holo, hatat ki kore hariye galo. That was forgotten so vigorously. First of all, one can see signs of both destruction and preservation quite prominently. No statue or icon of any deity has been beheaded in such large numbers as those of the Buddha. In fact, many actually associate him not with a full-bodied statue, but with a decapitated head. We see these truncated heads of Buddha in large numbers in museums and galleries all over India and the world. But do we ever ask who beheaded such a large number of Buddhist sculptures? The second tendency is of preservation of Buddhist statuaries that has been for the purpose of appropriating them within the larger religion. Kollan Kumar Dasgupta, one of the greatest professors of art history, who happened to be kind to me, cites several sculptures of Bodhisattva Avalokiteshvara in Bengal that have simply been worshipped all over Bengal as Lokeshwar sheep. That's all. These statues were taken on, and if it's a full statue without a chip, it is taken into the mandir. If it is chipped at any point, it is kept under the tree. Has been taken and worshipped at the popular Lokeshwar sheep in Bengal. Assimilation of diverse beliefs and even appropriating their best features has been part of the larger religion. It was not a grand design, it was an urge to take in the best. So therefore, intrinsic to Hinduism has been several contributions from Buddhism. Ahimsa as a concept, vegetarianism as a concept, the saffron robe, the institution of monasteries and monks. We did not have, we had ascetics, Rishi Muni. We never had the monastic institutions, and have all been internalized by the greater religion, major religion in India. Is there any evidence that Buddhism was physically eliminated? This is not the subject of the present talk, and this question is an explosive one. But one would only touch upon the issue and cite the legend of Mihir Kula, the Hun ruler who was converted to Brahmanism in the 6th century AD. He is reported to have unleashed a wave of violent destruction on Buddhist monasteries in Punjab and Kashmir. This is quoted by Kolhana in his Raja Tarangini 600 years later. Deeds of Pushyamitra Shunga, the Brahmin minister who overthrew the last Mauryan Buddhist ruler in Magad, are also cited to prove an anti-Buddhist reaction. Shashanka, the ruler of Gaur Bangla, took pride in the destruction of many stupas and is said to have cut down the sacred Bodhi tree at Gaya. Even the historian S.R. Goel mentions, quote unquote, according to many scholars, hostility of the Brahmanas was one of the major causes for the decline of Buddhism in India. A recent study of the Bengal Purans indubitably shows that Buddhists were mocked at, cast as mischievous in Brahmanical narratives, and subject to immense rhetorical violence. But rhetorical attacks are not the same as destruction. To be fair, at that period of religious rivalry, the reverse also happened, that Brahmanism was also painted in various lights. Those things happen in history. Epigraphica Indica, India, however, records that Veera Goggi Deva, a South Indian king, described himself, quote unquote, quote, a fire to the Jain scripture, adept at demolition of the Buddhist canon, unquote. It also records the deliberate destruction of non-Brahmanical literature, like the books of Lokayata Charvaka, philosophy of Brihaspati, that was mentioned by Al-Biruni in the 11th century. Similarly, Ian Longhurst, who conducted the excavations at Nagarjuna Konda, recorded in 1938 in his memoirs that the ruthless manner in which the buildings of Nagarjuna Konda have been destroyed is simply appalling. It cannot represent the work of treasure hunters. And so the controversy goes on. Now, then comes the role of Islam, and they have recorded exactly where they have destroyed Nalanda, Odantapuri, etc., in slaughtering thousands of monks. The point here is that there may have been occasions when overzealous groups have attacked or destroyed some of the edifices of Buddhism, but this does not appear to have been the usual modus operandi. There is no proof on that score. Small groups may have, for various interests, tried to go on and destroy. Before that, the word of mouth stigma was the slight that the sight or any image of the likeness of in Buddha was inauspicious, omongol barite rakha. These were more dangerous. Was perhaps dangerous and more effective in removing its memory from the mindscape of India than any real physical assault. What is interesting is that once Buddhism, this is the next most important thing, that once Buddhism was rediscovered, however, all of India came together to celebrate its glory. Most of the leaders were of the Brahmanical castes that were had earlier been accused of taking pains to erase the memory of Buddhism. What was done 1,000 years ago did not apply 1,000 years later. Now, as Anagarika Dharmapala has recounted, Nilkomal Mukherjee was one of those who helped him settle down and says that when he had visited Bodh Gaya in 1879 and witnessed the abandoned and neglected condition of the central shrine of Buddhism, he resolved to restore it. And who came forward to help him? It was Babu Nilkomal Mukherjee, who had remained, quote, true and loyal, encouraging and protecting at all crises in the subsequent history of Mahabodhi Society. Such sweet sympathy and so much human love I have shown that the utopian ideas of the resuscitation of Buddhism in the land of its birth actually came into its objectivity. At that point of time, when people looked at the structures and said, oh God, we can never restore them to their past glory, it was again people who came in from other religions, Hinduism and others, to help them. When Bodh Gaya Mahabodhi Society was founded in Sri Lanka in May 13, 1891, its cause was taken up not only by Buddhists but by also genuine people like Mary Elizabeth Foster. She was in fact known as the foster mother of Dharmapala. And Colonel Henry Alcott. About Alcott, Dharmapala complimented him as one who has dedicated all his life to Buddhism and the people of Asia. 1 year later, After the founding of the Mahabodhi Society, Karmayogi Kripasaran founded the Bengal Buddhist Association. Just 1 year later, in Kolkata, we are fortunate to get this opportunity to celebrate the 150th birth anniversary of Kripasaranji, and this year, and I have a special regard as a born in the district of my forefathers. Dharmapala also recalls how Sir Ashutosh Mukherjee was, when he was elected life president of the Mahabodhi Society in 1916, Dharmapala's record, we thought it an honor to have the foremost personality in Bengal as the president of the Mahabodhi Society. He was never a formal Buddhist, but he was Ashutosh Preta Oneki Janenna. He was completely committed to Buddhism. President, he was at heart a Buddhist. He openly confessed his love to the Lord Buddha and was always prepared to help the cause of Buddhism. The introduction of Pali in Calcutta University was due to his personal effort. We must remember at this juncture the role of Venerable Kripasaran in this momentous decision of Calcutta University and in starting the study of Pali in the schools and colleges. So many schools and colleges, because the difference is that he was a barefoot missionary. went about recognizing, teaching Pali. He urged Sir Ashutosh to extend the affiliation of many schools and colleges and thereby produce generations of scholars who would study the Buddhist texts once again and convey the sublime messages to the modern world. Venerable Kripasaran also selected 3 young students to go to the University of London for higher studies on government scholarship. And one of them was the iconic Beni Madhav Borua, who was associated with Dharmankur Sabha. Kripasaran was successful in convening the World Buddhist Conference, where monks and lay congregated from many parts of the world, and Buddhism was back on the radar of the world. Amir Samanto, one of my senior colleagues, reminds us that few had appreciated the teachings of Buddha so deeply as Rabindranath, whose creative genius drew inspiration from Buddha's teachings on social equality, on universal love and produced certain, some of the most magnificent literature of Tagore. To Tagore, Buddha was the greatest human being and therefore greatest human, and before whose image at Bodh Gaya he chose to prostrate himself. Tagore kintu Rabindranath Thakur kono dino matha noto korenni kono bhagoner samne. Ekbar Bodh Gaya ge uni hotat, this was very unusual for him, Rabindranath Tagore to go. He prostrated himself, an act that Tagore never did again in his whole life. Thus, even if there are definitely have been some feelings of bitterness in the past, there was no rancor in the minds of any Indian, Hindu or Buddhist when this great religion was rediscovered. In fact, the name of Buddha continues to be a favorite one among people of the state, irrespective of religion, who call their sons Amitabha, Gautama, Buddhadeva, Siddhartha, Tathagata, and so on. Buddha is now the collective pride of all Indians. Plays and dance dramas abound on his life, and in Bengal, other schools, Bengal and India, and other schools of art also draw inspiration from the Gautama Buddha. But it remains a major mystery to me as to how and why his contribution, as well as all major Buddhist monuments and art, how were they all forgotten, almost forgotten so completely for 1,000 years? I cannot choose to give you the answer. I can raise the question, provide some clues. Scholars need to work hard and come up with credible answers. Thank you. Thank you.